Always lose it right there. Good evening.
Good evening.
Okay, that was a little better. So, you guys get ready for some applause. I will not be preaching tonight. Thank you. Thank you. I knew it was coming. I had to go to Cleveland. You guys know, Monday, got home 10 o'clock at night, and then I had another doctor's appointment yesterday, and I'm ready anyway. I always have a sermon ready, but I had talked to Mark because he said he had a sermon on his heart. It was Sunday. So on the way up to Cleveland, I thought, well, that was the reason that the good Lord told him to tell me that. So I called him and asked him if he was wanting to preach Wednesday. And so, yeah. And so, and then, so like all day, I'm like, I can't stand not preaching. So I called him right before church, and I mean, texted him right before church and said, so are you preaching or do you need me? I'm ready. And he said, no, I'm already here and downloaded my program. I'm like, great, okay. So, nope, I love it when I get to be here to hear Mark and Don and John when they're preaching. And they don't always preach just when I'm out of town because I like to get fed and listen with you guys. And he's given me a preview of what he's preaching on, and I'm very excited to hear. So, I'll give you guys a couple of the prayer requests that we have. I won't go into a lot because on Wednesday nights we don't go into it. And then I'll turn it over to Mark after the music since it's going to be an hour and a half. I want to get you all out of here. First of all, I do ask you guys to be praying about the church. And we have two more weeks of kind of a respite where, you know, we had everything set up with the bank. But once we reach our halfway mark on the money that they lend to us, they have to send an inspector down to see how we're doing before they release the second half. So we're in that inspector period. And they came down, and I've already walked them through. So we're getting ready to pick back up with the second half. Everything's good, but it was just a formality. But in order to keep Wayne's guys working, because they've been working steadily on our church for months, he took a three-week job while we're waiting for the bank to do their thing. Really only needed about a week while we were waiting on the bank, but he had to keep his men working. So that was good. And that gives us a breather to set things up for the next phase and to do things a little slower, make sure we do things the way we need to. So all is still going well, and I'll keep you guys up to date as we draw closer on when we might be able to get in. We won't know for a while longer. There's just so many factors. So I'll keep you guys posted as we go. But said all that to say this. I have started myself fasting just over the building and praying, and I've talked to you guys about it. This is my crew. So if you will join me in continued prayer and fasting, maybe pick a day a week just to fast over that, whether it's a meal, whether it's half a day, whether it's a whole day, whatever you do, just to show God how serious and passionate we are to watch Him work. And it's all Him, and I can't wait to see what He's going to do. So, and the cool thing is, and I was talking with Crystal about this last week, honestly, I'm at a point, I'm excited about this building because it opens up ministry opportunities. But I could care less if we met in my garage from now on. And if things keep changing the way they are in society, it may come to that. And that's not a joke. Because you guys are the church. And I love what God has done to bring this family together. And I pray He keeps us humble and unified to the day the trump sounds. But wherever we get to meet, I'm okay with that. But I sure do want this building. So just join me in prayer and fasting, if you would. And I just want to mention the names Emily Seitz and Daisy. And Don is, he's out, he's sick, he's not got COVID or anything like that. But you know, with the heart problems that he has when he's sick, it hits him hard and he needs to be home resting. Sarah is back at the emergency room. I think she's doing all right, but she's, I can't remember what Don told me. He just sent me a text right before I came to church. She's been hit so hard with so many things, this poor girl. So I do ask you to remember Sarah Kinzer in prayer. And be in prayer for Mark as he brings the word. And if you guys will stand with me. And guys, Our nation is standing on the edge of the cliff. Be in real prayer for our nation. And if you haven't heard, the newest thing that's come out about Israel now is that Israel staged October 7th and killed their own people. And it's, believe it or not, catching on. So be in prayer for Israel and be a mouth for Israel, because the world's gotten nuts. So, all right. Don't just listen to me pray. This is our time to tug on God's heartstrings, okay? So join me in prayer and have expectation that He's going to bring the Word. And guys, when we worship, let's make this be the place Jesus wants to be. Let it be real, okay? Let's perform for Him. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we come to You. And Lord, if we counted all the blessings that we have now and that we have coming because of the blood of Christ, we could never stop counting. The blessings that we have coming after this world is over that we don't even know about will be endless and uncountable. And Lord, You didn't have to do any of it. All the magnificence of Your creation, and You came to be one of us to save us. And Lord, You're going to destroy that entire creation and start all over just because of Your love for us. Help that to sink into our hearts, to see just how much You love, just how much You want to sacrifice to bring us home to You. And Lord, let it just compel us to love You and serve You. We give our future as individuals. We give our future as a church totally to You. We're Your servants. Lord, let us be in Your will. Let us do what You want us to do. I do know that that involves the love and the unity and the passion of my brothers and sisters as we join together to serve You. Lord, I pray You should protect this church. I pray You'd give us more passion, more sacrifice than we ever have. Help us to shine brighter and brighter, Lord, as the world gets darker. Lord, we do pray for Israel, that You'd give them strength, that You'd let them see who their Messiah is, and that You'd let the world see Your hand is on them and that You are real. And Lord, we do lift up Emily and Daisy and Sarah and Don, Tracy Smith, my brother Mike Saunders and his wife, Michael Spencer, Jim Gabehart, Lord, Tim and Laura. We claim the blood of Jesus Christ. We thank You for giving us the right and the privilege. And I ask You to touch them, not only physically, but emotionally and spiritually, Lord. Let them feel Your presence. And Lord, I ask You to be with Mark. Use him as Your mouthpiece. Let him speak and worship. And Lord, let us hear what You have to say through him. We love You, Lord. We praise You. In Jesus Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Down into darkness, open my eyes, let me see beauty that made this heart adore you, hope of a life spent with you. Here I am to worship, here I am to say that you're my God, you're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me. King of all days, oh so highly exalted, in heaven above, humbly you came to the earth you created, all for love's sake became poor. Here I am to worship, here I am to bow down, here I am to say
Heavenly Father, I come to you. Lord, I thank you for my brother. And Lord, I just ask you now to put your words in his heart. Let everything he says be for you in an act of worship. Give him a heart for the people that's your heart. Strengthen him through the Spirit. Let him bring your word unhindered. And Lord, help us to receive it in the same way. We love you, Lord. We praise you.
Yes,
in
Lord.
Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. no, you didn't. Oh, no, you didn't. Oh, my gosh.
See, he is up front tonight.
Wow. I still love you. But it's being tested.
That's just a few years old. And I think there's some hair on that head. It's good to be here. You know, I talked to Doug before service and I'm like, Lord, this is not a sermon for me to bring. It's for the pastor of the church to bring. He said, well, you're a pastor. It's your job. But this is one I argue with God about. And I'm like, Lord, I don't know who needs to hear it, but you do. I don't know what I'm going to say because God's always the one that puts the words in my mouth. And I pray that he would tonight. I want to start out in 2 Peter, the first chapter, 10th verse. It says, therefore, brethren. Now he's got our attention. He's saying, listen to what I'm going to say here. I haven't put it up yet, Doug. Therefore, brethren, be even more diligent. I'm going to read it slow so it can sink in. To make your call and election sure. Everybody thinks this is a verse for preachers and teachers and deacons and elders and stuff, but it's for the church also. We need to make sure that we're sure where we're at. What we're doing for God. How we're doing for God. For if you do these things, you'll never stumble. Now, the lesson I have tonight, and I've told Doug I started on it and worked about 5 or 6 hours yesterday. Got up this morning about 7 o'clock and worked on it. About 2 more hours. Had a doctor's appointment, got back from it, and after I got situated, worked on 2 or 3 more hours, and every time I went back to it, God changed it. Moved it around one way or the other, and right before I come to church, he had me rearrange the whole thing. So it's his message, not mine. But that's where I started at, and you know, that's where God gave it to me when I was talking to Doug the other day. And I went to another church Sunday night just to visit. It seemed like the pastor visited on the same thing that God had put on my heart. And I think it's a message for the church tonight. I think it's a message for all the church, and it's not one to beat you down. You know, we're not here to do that. And as I was telling Pastor Doug before church, if you look through the Bible, most of the Bible was written to the church. It wasn't written to the people of the world. It was instructions for us to witness to other people. But for us to be a good witness, we have to have our life in line with God's. And we just have to... This message, lesson, whatever you want to call it, I'm going to depend upon God to give it all. Because as I said, I even sat back there next to Brenda at the first part of the service, and I'm like, okay, God, this doesn't make sense to me right now. I just don't understand where you're going with it. He said, it's not your problem, it's mine. I've already got it laid out. And as we start into it, okay, which button do I push, Doug?
Second one from the bottom.
Second one from the bottom. Okay, there we go. And I was thinking about Simon Peter. He's the one that wrote the first words that I read. You know, the verses come out, Simon Peter, a bondservant, an apostle to Jesus Christ, to those who obtained the precious faith with us by the righteousness of our God and Savior Jesus Christ. Grace and peace be multiplied to you in the knowledge of God and of Jesus Christ, our Lord. You know, Peter there was introducing himself and telling him what his authority to do what he is doing when he wrote this letter. His authority through Jesus Christ, God, and to write to people and to give them instructions. And I truly believe that's what God does today with the ministers of the church. If they're following his will, following what he has them to do, he will give them the instructions to give to the church that they don't have to come up with the message. God gives them the message. And any pastor gets up here and tries to give you exactly what they want to give you, there's something wrong. I don't want to give you something you want to hear. I don't want to give you something that I want to say. I want to give you something that God gives you. Because as Peter said here, we're bond servants. We're willing servants to God. We're willing to give our life and dedicate our life to God, that he may use us to tell the other people, tell our brothers and sisters, tell our family, tell everyone that we're acquainted with about him. You know, so many times as I was thinking about, and God was showing me that we're out here, we come to church, yeah, we worship God, and so many times we go out of here and we don't witness. We're not the witness that we need to be. How many people do we, and I know I get on this every time I'm up here, but maybe there's a reason. How many times do we get out there, and once we leave church, once we do get out there, we meet people on the street we never even mention God to. They're in need of help. There's somebody that's looking for something more than just physical, monetary, whatever. They need help spiritually. And being a bond servant, being a servant that we willingly give our life for God to control, makes us obligated to share his word. The servant was one that did everything that the master required of him. And God requires us to tell the world about what Jesus did for us, about the plan of salvation, and where they can go if they serve the Lord. And the love that Jesus Christ, you know, there's too many people that's going serving God just to go to heaven.
Amen.
I'm not serving God to go to heaven. I'm serving God so that I can live a life and love him and show other people about the love Jesus Christ has. You know, unless we have that love, we're the bondservant of that love, then we have nothing to say to anyone. We can't witness to anyone without God's love in our heart. It won't do any good. The world's telling everybody every day what the world wants them to hear. They're wanting them to play with the foolishness of the world and do the things that the world wants. And he, to those who obtain the like precious faith. You know that faith that he had back then is still available today. And I was looking at that and I was thinking about the faith. And you know, it takes a lot of faith in these days, but it takes no faith that we have. It takes the faith of the Lord Jesus Christ that he gives us. You know, so many times we get involved in what we do, how I went out and witnessed to this one, how I went out and did this, how many times I've given to the church, how much I've shown other people. But all we need to show people is Jesus Christ, the love of Christ. He said he is love. And how can we love without having his love in us? That is a question. How do we love without having Jesus Christ in us? You know, we all hug each other. We all have this thing that we have camaraderie and this, but we have to have Jesus Christ in our life to love. That's one of the greatest gifts he ever gave me, was the ability to love. Even in our churches, there's people that don't show the love of Jesus Christ. They come in, they sit in the pew, they listen to Pastor Doug, they go home, and that's it. They don't have the love. Love is very precious. And I don't know where all this came from. This is just sidebar. Grace and peace be multiplied to you. If you look at most of the Bible, the first verse talks about grace and peace and love. Most of the New Testament, because that's what it's all built upon. If we love someone, we're wanting peace in their life. We want grace in our life. But God's grace is all we have. I can't give you grace. I can't forgive you of your sins. I can't show you what is right. It only comes through Jesus Christ and his love and the word he gave us. And you know, we got to realize the word of God is our only source of true knowledge of God. The pastor teaches, the ministers minister, but it only comes through the word of Jesus Christ. If they don't have that, then they don't have anything to show us. In Galatians, the 5th chapter, 22nd verse, it says, but the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. Against all such things, there is no law. And those who belong to Jesus, Christ Jesus, has crucified the flesh with his passions and desires. If we live by the Spirit, you know, it's going through all these things that we have that are the fruit of the Spirit. You know, if you are a Christian, there is each one of these to one extent or another that's in your life that you should possess. If you don't have love, then you don't have the Spirit. If you don't have joy, you better be praying that the Spirit comes more in you. Because I walk around and I see Christians today that looks like they should have been mummified 20 years ago. Because there's no joy in their life. There's no joy. You know, one of the best things that ever happens to me, when I get set back and I get to see it, tell somebody about Jesus Christ. There's a joy in my heart. Even though in my worst times, in the times that I didn't think there was a tomorrow, when the times I didn't have an idea of what's going to come up next, how I was going to make the next payment on something, how I was going to do this, God put a joy in my heart. He gave me something to be happy about. He gave me salvation through Him. And if you don't have that joy, if you're always at odds with things, then you don't have Christ in your life. There has to be joy for the Spirit to dwell within you. But the fruit of the Spirit, you know, the Spirit bears fruit. And such as the Spirit bearing fruit, the Spirit should bear fruit through us. If the Spirit doesn't bear fruit through us, then we need to be back talking to the Lord and getting things right. That joy, love, peace. And this next one's one that most people have trouble with. Patience. You know that new convert that's still out there? And I talked to pastors, and I talked to preachers, I talked to all these people. Well, they should have, as soon as they got saved, they should have gave all that stuff up. You know, if a person's got a habit, if something's in their life that's been in their life for years, they're going to go back to it every once in a while until the Spirit takes it away from them. We've got to have patience with them. You know, if we don't have patience with them, we're going to run them away from God instead of drawing them in. There's people that sit on our pews today, and even our church, that have things that they're doing wrong, that if we told them every day and beat them over the head with it, we'd run them off before we got them in. Self-control is another one I like. That's one of the hardest things for me to have. Control what I'm going to do. And sometimes it's not what God wants me to do, but I just got to pray about it. And that self-control also goes to witnessing to people. I'm getting back to that. We're beating them over the head too much. You know, you got to love them, but you can't compromise. As a church today, I really feel like we're compromising too much. Because right now, we're all in this thing. Christ is going to come back any minute. Christ is going to be here any time. It may be tomorrow. It may be the next day, but He's coming. But we're not out doing what He said. We're not witnessing. We don't have this urgency with our families. And as God told me the other day, we're going to let them die and go to hell and not worry about it. That's not Christ. Christ mentions that we should be telling everyone. You know, even upon the cross, when He was dying, He was a witness to that thief right next to Him. But we can't take out 5 minutes from anything to tell the person next to him that He loves them, that He is the Savior of the world. I find myself guilty. I don't know about you. But even if we're ancient as I am or as young as the kids are, we all should be witnessing for God. Those who belong to Christ Jesus has crucified the flesh with its passions and desires. Have you crucified your flesh? Have you given up the things in your life that you know is wrong and let them go? Let them die. You know, if something dies, you don't want it on you. You don't want to touch it. You don't want it near you. So why is the sin in your life still there? And I may be preaching to somebody out on internet. You guys may not even need this message, but God told me to do it. You know, I was looking at it and I came part to the part where it says in my mind, fruitfulness grows in faith. To be fruitful, you got to grow in faith. In Hebrews, the 11th chapter, the first verse, it says, now faith is the substance of things hoped for. And every one of us should know this verse because I've heard it from the time I was that tall until where I'm at now. Now fruit is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. Do we have the faith that we're doing what God has us to do? This may not be the fiery message I expected, but it's the message that God's giving. But now faith is the substance of things hoped for. You know, we all have hopes. We all have dreams. But do we have the hopes and dreams of what? Our family getting into heaven. Our neighbors getting to heaven. Our fellow people in the church, because our churches are loaded with sinners, people who don't know God. Do we have hope and faith that they're going to make it? That we're going to witness to them. They're going to come one more service and God's going to touch their soul and they're going to come up to the Lord. Do we have that faith? Do we have that hope? For by it the elders obtained a good testimony. Our pastor has a testimony. God gave him a testimony to share with each and every one of us. You know, if there was a service I ever come here that something doesn't touch my heart, I'm going to come down here and see if I'm dead. Because every service, everything I hear when I come to church should touch my heart in one way or the other. If it's not touching you, if it's not bringing out, if it doesn't show you something, you need to check and see where you're standing spiritually. By faith, we understand that the worlds were framed by the Word of God, so that the things which were seen were not made of things which are visible. No, our salvation wasn't brought by something visible. It's brought by the love of God. Something we can't see. You know, I never saw Christ upon the cross. I never saw the apostles teaching. I never saw God create the earth. I never saw Noah in the flood. I never saw any things. But I had the faith to believe that God put them in those places. God created me. God created the universe. He created all things and the testimony we should bear. God gave us the faith to believe it. It's not something we have. We can't generate faith. There's no faith within us. We're a faithless bunch of people. But through Jesus Christ, we obtain faith through the Holy Spirit. But without faith, it is impossible to please Him. For he who comes to God must believe that He is and that He is a rewarder of those who diligently seek Him. You know, we must come to this point where we understand and understand that He is there. And that is a lot of times why we don't serve the Lord the way we need to. We really don't believe He's out there sometimes. We think He's only watching every once in a while. He's got too many people out in the world He has to watch for. He can't see me all the time. I get a break every once in a while. I can do what I want. That's not how it works, church. God has our heart in His eyes at all times. Just as He's watching what we're doing, He's got His Spirit down here protecting us as we're doing it. He puts a shield about us that the world can't get to us if we have the faith to believe He's there. Our faith has grown so weak. The world has grown so strong in our churches, in our hearts, in our families, that they're just pushed aside. We live for what we want to live for, what we want to do. We don't have to do this. God's no longer watching. The apostles aren't here. The preacher's at his house doing what he's doing. So I don't have to do it. We don't have the faith to know that God is watching and protecting us at all times. And then there's a virtue. We had to have virtue. In Philippians 4th chapter 8th verse, finally, brethren, whatever things are true, whatever things are true. What did Jesus say He is? He said He's the truth. So whatever things are true, whatever things are the truth, whatever things are of God, whatever things are noble. He is a king. He's the most noble person, most noble being in existence. And this is where I was at earlier today. Whatever things are just. Now, just is a serious word. I tell you, you don't want a just God before you. Because if we got what we should have, if he judged us on what we should be, we'd all be in hell in agony for eternity. Whatever things are just. Whatsoever things are pure. And there's only one purity, and that's Christ. But through his Spirit, we can become pure. Whatever things are lovely. Whatsoever things are of good report. Now let me stop there. How many of us are bringing a good report? Do you bring a good report before Jesus Christ right now? Only through his Spirit, through his love, do we bring a good report. By his blood. You know, if we didn't have his blood, we'd be worthless. We would not have a good report. If there is any virtue, if there is anything praiseworthy, meditate on these. Meditate upon the good, upon the trustworthy, upon the noble. Meditate upon these things. Don't look at the evil and wish you had it. You know, so many times we think, well, if I just had a few more dollars, if I had just another time doing this, I would do it different. I would want it. But we shouldn't be looking at those things. We should be looking at the witness of God, of what we can give to others. The greatest gift I can give you tonight would be Jesus Christ and his righteousness and his knowledge. You know, we've got to have knowledge of the Word. We've got to have knowledge of God. We've got to have knowledge of salvation and where we're at. You've got to have knowledge of what you're doing, whether you're living right or wrong. Thank you, Chris. Knowledge of what you're doing. 1 Corinthians, the first chapter, fourth verse says, I thank my God always concerning you for the grace of God which is given to you by Jesus Christ. The grace of God given to us by Jesus Christ. Grace is so undeserved. Grace is something we'll never be what we should get, but he gave it freely. I thank my God always concerning you for the grace of God, which was given to you by Jesus Christ, that you are enriched in everything by him, in all utterance and in all knowledge, by the testimony of Jesus Christ, was confirmed in you. You know, we only get that knowledge when we have Christ in us. I've heard and I've talked to so many people who says, well, I just can't understand what the Bible says. I can't understand what the preacher's talking about. I just don't understand. I don't have the knowledge to be able to, I can't figure it out. Well, it takes Jesus Christ and his Spirit living with you for you to figure out what's going on. Figure out what God's got for you to do. You know, it took faith tonight for me to get up here because I knew God wanted me to say something, and it's not what I'm saying tonight. It's different. It's the same scripture, and as I said right before I left, before Brenda got up and got ready for church, I moved four or five scriptures around and moved frames around and did all this stuff and added scripture. So it's kind of fresh to me too tonight. Self-control. How many of us really have self-control? I know I spoke about it a minute ago. Do we control ourselves? So when we're driving down the road and somebody cuts us off, do we get angry? Somebody comes up to you and starts cussing you out for what you think is no reason at all. Do we get angry? Do we say things we shouldn't? The waitress or waiter brings us the wrong food or it's cold or something's in it. Do we get angry? But what we do after we get angry is what makes a difference. It says anger, but sin not. Do you sin when you get angry? Self-control. A man without self-control is like a city broken into and left without walls. The devil has come. The evil one has come and broken down your walls and got to your inner part, that you can no longer be a witness for God because you have thrown God out of the picture and just torn everything down as your witness. You had to start all over, start with that one block and build it back up so that that person can see in your life that you really do have Christ and that you're trying to live for Him. Yes, we will get angry, but we shouldn't say the things that was not pleasing to God, that doesn't reflect good on God. Anger, but sin not. There's the first page. Perseverance. Are we persevering to the end? You know, I was thinking about that. How many people I've seen, my family, my neighbors in the past, or even in our church. I was talking to Pastor Doug about a month ago, and I was saying, you know, Doug, since I've been here, there's a lot of people that's no longer here that hasn't persevered to stay in church, to serve God. They let the world come in their heart. Let the world draw them out so they no longer seek God. Matthew 10th chapter, 22nd verse, it says, and you will be hated by all for my name's sake, but the one who endures to the end will be saved. Matthew 24:13 says, but the one who endures to the end will be saved. It doesn't say that it's going to be easy. It doesn't say that you're just going to be able to walk through life and you're going to be able to skip and have a good time. When you persevere, that means there's problems. It means that you're going to have a hard time. That it's not going to be a garden of roses to stop and smell every rose, but you're going to have the thorns there to fill. You got to persevere. You got to work for it. No, working for your salvation doesn't work. It takes the blood of Jesus Christ. But once you're saved, you got to work to get others in. You got to be able to witness to them. And the biggest witness is, as Brother back here and I was talking before church, it's how we live. It's if we get angry and start blasting our mouth at somebody, or do we say, I understand, things happen. But let me tell you about my Savior. He's the one who gives me this heart where I don't have to get up and get back in your face. You know, that's hard to do. I was out in the rain last Wednesday night. I had a tire, and I met a tire blow out on a pothole. I was angry with the city. I was angry with the state. I was angry about everything. And the rain was the hardest it had been all day. And I'm not bragging on myself. And this little girl, when I was got finished putting my tire on, went over to the sheets and started, see if the air would go in it. Come over to me and said, can you show me how to jack up my car? I was eager to tell her because I knew I was going to get to tell her something else. I was able to tell her about Jesus Christ. Even though she was out there in the rain and everything seemed bad to her, I was able to tell her about Jesus Christ. Doug and I have been in the worst positions, having surgery and everything, and we've had time to tell people about Jesus Christ. We had to persevere through the bad times to get to the good times, to be able to tell other people that unless they change their way, if our family doesn't change their way and start accepting Jesus Christ as their Savior, they're going to die and go to hell. And sometimes I wonder if we're not witnessing, God's going to hold it against us, and we may not be where we think we're going. We may not make it in because the love isn't there. If you love something, you don't try to destroy it. You try to save it. Godliness. Having nothing to do with irreverent, silly myths. Train yourself in godliness. As 1 Timothy, the 4th chapter, 7th verse and 8th verse goes, and while bodily training is of some value, godliness is of value in every way as it holds promise for the present life and also for the life to come. Are we godly? Do we try to show God to everyone? Do we try to lift God up and let Him be the first witness? I can tell you all day long what God did for you, but unless I have the love of God and show you that God loves you and become a godly man, you'll never buy it.
Amen.
You've got to be that godly person. You can't go around after you're out of church cussing and doing all this other stuff, living like the world, sleeping around, getting drunk, and all this stuff, because it's not godly. You know, it tells us there that, yeah, we can build up this body. We can keep this body in perfect shape. But unless you have the love of Jesus Christ in you and build up your spirit, it's no value. You know, you're going to lay this body down someday. It's going to rot and do whatever body does. But the spirit will live on forever. And if you don't have a godly spirit, it's going to go to hell. A lot of people don't want to tell you you're going to hell unless you have Jesus Christ. It's going to offend you. Well, be offended. Because I always tell you that if you don't serve God, you're going to hell. I've got family members. I was telling the brother before church, I've got a niece that's not living a godly life as far as you can about go from God. But I've got to love her and show her what a godly life is, that she may find God and get out of the situation she's in, or else she's going to hell. You know, that's the worst thought I could ever find, is someone going to hell. Have you thought about that? Even a stranger, them going to hell and suffering for eternity, being so far away from God. I couldn't imagine being away from God's presence. Because while we're here on earth, we still have God's presence about us. Could you imagine if it just all went away? How it would feel? What loneliness there'd be? What darkness there'd be around us? How awful it'd be? Scary to me. My heart just doesn't even want to comprehend it. Brotherly kindness. 1 Thessalonians 4th chapter 9th verse. Now concerning brotherly love, you have no need for anyone to write you, for you yourselves have been taught by God to love one another. Hebrews the 13th chapter 1st verse says, let brotherly love continue. God has to teach us to love. Did you catch that? You shall. Now concerning brotherly love, you have no need to write, anyone to write to you, for yourselves have been taught by God to love one another. You can't love another person without God showing you how. Why do you think there's so many murders? Why do you think there's so many people being abused? Why do you think there's so much evil about us? Because people doesn't know who God is, and God can't tell them what love is. Every day, even here in Charleston, it seems like 3 or 4 times a week, I hear somebody getting killed, somebody getting hurt, people abusing the children, people doing everything that would break your heart because they don't know God and they don't know love. Doesn't it just make your heart want to break? Make you just want to cry for the world? But yet here we are not telling them who God is and what God has done for them, the way salvation should be brought to them.
Amen.
We need as a church to learn brotherly love. We are to love those outside the church, outside the family. We just don't have to live like them. We need to love and put that love of God to them. I think everybody here knows that if they come here to church very long, they'll get a hug from me. If I don't hug you, you haven't had enough time yet. I'll get there. Because that's how I show God's love. There's people in the world I go out and give a hug, and they look at me like I'm crazy. But it's God I'm trying to show them. Now, I'm not patting myself on the back. I'm not trying to say, look how good I am, because I'm the least of God's servants. I'm the one at the bottom of the list. And his blood was shed exactly for me to help me get to where I'm at. Love. Matthew 22, 37. He said unto him, you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your mind. This is the great and first commandment. The second is like it. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. Do we really love our neighbors ourselves? Do we love those around us as ourselves? If we did, then we're going to say we're going to send ourselves to hell because we don't tell them about God. If you love them as much as yourself, you'd be spreading the word of Jesus Christ with them. You'll be telling them what God said. How salvation is free. As I said, I don't know why God's got me up here saying this tonight, but he did. And I hope you can feel the Spirit. Do you love him? Do you love him enough to tell him that you're going to go to hell? Some people we may tell that want to tell them that you wish they were there, but that's not of the Spirit either. But that's the devil. The only one I ever hope to go to hell is the devil. Because he went against my Savior. He went against all things. But how many people do you love enough to tell them they're going to hell? Some of us without witnesses and telling everybody in our family that. We need to get to where we have enough love for Christ that we tell people who Christ is. And I've been going through the things that as a church, the things that we should have and the things that we should concentrate on. But so many times in the church, there's another part of it that God has to pull us away from. God has to take out of our life. Galatians, the fifth chapter. Whoops. Yeah, there I am. Starting with the 19th verse. Now the works of the flesh are evident. Sexual immorality. Impurity. Sensuality. Idolatry, sorcery, enmity, strife, jealousy, fits of anger, rivalries, dissensions, divisions, envy, drunkenness, orgies, and the things like these. I warn you, as I warned you before, that those who do such things will not inherit the kingdom of God. Now let's get right serious with ourselves. We see the list that was put in there. Can any of us say that even as Christians we don't visit some of those sins? Well, I'm not that bad. You know, it's sexual immorality. Even if you think of another in a sexual way, you're visiting that sin. Fornication. How many people fornicate today? Well, we're going to get married next week, next month. It won't hurt anything. God hadn't joined you yet, so it is wrong. Impurity. We have impure thoughts about us that we need to get under control. Sensuality. Idolatry. That one should hit every one of us in our head, right in the middle of our heart, because we all have our own gods besides Jesus Christ. Gods that we worship, but nobody knows about. Maybe that paycheck. May even be our spouse we put before God. Our children. That brand new car that you just bought. I'll stay home and clean it instead of going to church. I'll have to work an extra shift on Sunday just to make the payment. Sorcery. And a lot of people don't realize this includes those fortune tellers. Those silly things that the devil has put before us witchcraft. I've seen church members run to the fortune tellers. They say it's just a joke. It's not a joke to Satan. And if he can get you in that one position, he'll come into your life and take it for the rest of your life. Strife. Now that's one that will break up churches in a heartbeat. Somebody in there telling little rumors or saying things about another person or doing different things that they just can cause a little turmoil in the church. It won't hurt anything. Fits of anger, jealousy, rivalries. Well, I'm going to be just as good as that Doug one of these days. I'm going to have just what she... I just wish I had that truck that Marcia has. It's just one of the best little trucks I've ever seen. Maybe she'll lose it and I can drive it sometime. Dissensions, divisions. Brother Doug, how many times has the church been divided because of one or two people? Envy, drunkenness. You know, it just doesn't mean on beer or alcohol. That can be the little things that get you really happy and giddy because you're doing them. It isn't alcohol or drugs. We can get drunk on the things we do. Orgies. Doesn't mean always with humans. We can have orgies with demons. We can play with our thoughts and let them in. Let them. Wouldn't it be fun to have this one, that one, and that one? We got to master those thoughts. And things like these, that's not the whole list. You know where the rest of the list is? God puts it right here for us to know. This is where we started out, but it's not the end. Therefore, brethren, be even more diligent to make your call and election sure. So, for if you do these things, you will never stumble. The words I've given you, plus the words that God puts in your heart, if you do those things, you'll never fall away from Jesus Christ. If you live in the Word, if you live by what God told you, you'll never fall away from Jesus Christ. If the Spirit is telling you something's wrong, and sometimes it's telling you need to do something. If you're telling you it's wrong and you do it, or if you're telling you to do it and you don't do it, it's sin. What does the Bible say about sin? It will never enter into the kingdom of God. God cannot look upon sin. That's why Christ had to die, why he had to shed his blood for us, that God would not be able to see us without sin. He'd cover that sin up. He'd get rid of it. That we could enjoy his presence. You know, even as I'm speaking up here tonight, I can feel God's presence because the blood of Jesus Christ has covered me. I'm doing one of the things he called me to do. I'm doing the witness that so many times we don't do. Are you witnessing? Are you telling people at school? Are you telling people at work? Are you telling people around you what Jesus Christ and what he's done? Where are you going? Does your neighbors know that you're a Christian? Do they know you stand for God? He who loves his life will lose it. He who hates his life in this world will keep it for eternal life. If anyone serves me, let him follow me, and where I am there, my servant will be also. If anyone sees me, him my Father will honor. He who loves his life will lose it. It doesn't mean you're going to die. Doesn't mean you're going to get killed. It means that you're going to lose all the things you have been doing, and you're going to start a new road. He who hates his life in this world will keep it for eternal life. He who hates the sin and everything our body craves to do, everything we want to do, if we don't give it up, we're not going to make it, to put it blunt. And witnessing's, you know, if you witness and try to live that witness, you don't have a hard time giving all this stuff up, because you don't want anybody seeing the sin. You don't want to see anybody, tempt anybody. You know, if you've got a brother or sister that falls into a sin and you do that sin in front of them, you're tempting them. And you're going to cause them to fall by the wayside. If anyone serves me, let him follow me. Are we following Christ? Are you following Christ? You know, I was thinking just then, from the time Jesus started his ministry, even before, there wasn't a minute, there wasn't an hour, there wasn't a day that he wasn't serving God and witnessing. As he walked down the road, he saw somebody by the well. He told them about his Father. As he is up on a cross and dying, he witnessed for God. As he was calling his apostles, he was a witness for God. Every single minute, every single day. And he had flesh just like you do. He had flesh just like you do, doing the same temptations he had that we have. Yet we can't go out for 5 minutes witnessing for God. We can't stand up and tell people about God. Now, I'm not talking about you. I'm talking about me. But if you fit in the boat, come and ride with me. And he came and found them sleeping. And he said to Peter, Simon, are you asleep? Could you not watch for 1 hour? Is that what God's telling you tonight? Are you asleep? Are you just sleeping through this life? You couldn't stay up with me and do what I need? You know, I'm sure that broke Simon Peter's heart when God said that. Just crushed him. But yet he's calling us that today. Can't you just work a little more and not sleep as much? Can't you do what I want? You see what I did? I'm died for you. I've gone through so much agony and pain. I gave it all up. I gave heaven and everything about it up. I gave out. I even went out of my Father's presence that you could have eternal life. Can't you just be awake for another hour? Can't you just serve me just a little bit more? Can't you do what the Father has called you to do? Are we asleep tonight, church? And if the trumpet blows, are we going to sleep through that? As the shout of the archangel comes, are you going to sleep through that spiritually? Can't you just stay up another hour? Can't you just witness one more time? Can't you show your family, your friends, the community, the church, that you're serving the one true and only God? If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us. So if none of this stuff didn't hit you, you're deceiving yourself. And the truth is not in you. And who is the truth? Go back to the beginning. Jesus said, I am the truth. And he's saying here, if this stuff doesn't, if you don't do this stuff, then Jesus isn't in you. You know, tonight, as we finish up, yeah, Doug, I went a little long.
I was just going to sleep there.
But, you know, if we don't do what we're called to do, it's sin in our life. If you don't witness, it's sin in your life. Amen. A sinner will not enter into the gates of God. Thank the Lord that I could be here tonight. Thank you, Pastor Doug, for letting me. God bless you.
Mark, I'm not even going to change my message, but you wouldn't believe the message I have in my heart for Sunday, how much they intertwine. So I know that's why God told you to bring it. And when God repeats something, he's trying to give us a signal. So I'm going to stay true, and you'll see how God surely made you bring that message tonight. Although I did get worried like I never had before when you stopped and pointed to the word orgy as though you were going to go into a long... You could stop.
Did it? I saw the look on your face.
That was a wonderful, wonderful message. And I thank you. And you're dead on. If we're not witnessing in some way, Christ can't be in our hearts because that's his love. That's his love for the world. And if it's not in us, how can we say he's in us? And I truly appreciate it. So if everybody will stand with me, we're going to close in prayer. And Brother Mark, I appreciate you. That was wonderful. Heavenly Father, I thank you for the message you brought tonight. And I pray, Lord, it would challenge every one of our hearts. It has challenged my heart. Thank you for using Mark. Lord, every one of us, if we don't have a love and a desire for the lost world, we should let it be a signal to ourselves that we're not following you closely. Lord, help us just be real with ourselves. Help us get over our worry about what we would look like and what it would take out of our lives, and not find our identity in anything else except bringing your face, your love to the world. Lord, that's our whole mission. That's the whole reason you haven't taken us home. Help us really realize that. Not just in a cliche, Lord, but know that's why we're here. Help us to decrease so you can increase through us. And Heavenly Father, we close. I join our hearts and our minds with our brothers and sisters to just tell you that we praise you. And we love you. And we thank you for what you've done for us. We thank you for what you're going to do. We thank you for the love that you have in your hearts that we cannot even understand. Thank you for your long suffering for us. So many times we let you down, Lord, and you're still there. Help us to be that way for the world. Holy Spirit, help us now as we close to lift up our precious Jesus with all of our heart, in Jesus Christ's name.
Despised by the world, has a one. wondrous attraction for me. For the dear Lamb of God left his glory above to bear it to dark Calvary. So I'll cherish the old rugged cross till my trophies at last I lay down. I will cling to the old rugged cross and exchange it someday for a crown. To the old rugged cross I will ever be true. Its shame and reproach gladly bear. Then he'll call me someday to my home far away, where his glory forever I'll share. So I'll cherish the old rugged cross till my trophies at last I lay down. I will cling to the old rugged cross and exchange it someday for a crown. So I'll cherish the it someday for a crown.
Are you hurting and broken within? Sin, Jesus is calling. Have you come to the end of yourself? Do you thirst for a drink from the well? Jesus is calling. Oh, come to the altar. Arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Leave behind your regrets and mistakes. isn't he wonderful? Sing hallelujah, Christ is risen. Sing hallelujah, Christ is risen.